So as we all know, we're in the middle of the month of Elul. As we started blowing the shofar every morning, although blowing a shofar is only a minhag, it's a custom. The biblical mitzvah doesn't begin until Rosh Hashanah. Nevertheless, we start blowing shofar to get us into the mood to think about, wake us up from our slumber and to become better. As well as we say, L'David Hashem Ori, and among the Svardim, they already started saying Slichos, the extra prayers, which we'll begin to say shortly. We don't begin a month before. We begin usually the Saturday night before. We need at least to get 4 days in. And then we go straight through. We do during Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur as well. So one of the things we do before Rosh Hashanah, Ezra instituted, as we'll see the Gemara Megillah, Daf Lamed Aleph Amid Beis, the Gemara tells us is that Ezra instituted that we read the Tochacha, the portion of the rebuke, before Rosh Hashanah. In other words, twice a year he instituted we read the Tochacha. Once before Shavuos, we read in the third book of Moses, Bichukosai. And once we read this coming Shabbos, in Parashas Kisavo, we read about the Tochacha. And one is before Shavuos, which is also a Yantav, a new year. It's a Rosh Hashanah Le'ilanos for, as we'll see, well that's actually, we'll see, Shavuos, that's also Tu B'Shav, we'll get into Shavuos later, but Rosh Hashanah, we all know, is Judgment Day. It's a day where all, the whole world gets judged. So Ezra instituted that we read the Tochacha, the portion of rebuke, right before Rosh Hashanah. So that's what we're going to be reading. So we'll discuss that a little bit. So the Gemara in Megillah, the Mishnah tells us an interesting halacha. The Mishnah says, Ein mafsikin bekolos. We don't break up the Tochacha. We know, as the Mishnah tells us in Megillah, on different days of the year, we call up different amounts of people from the Torah, for the Torah. So we on a Monday and Thursday, we call up 3. You know, Rosh Chodesh 4, Yontif 5, Yom Kippur 6, and Shabbos 7. So the Mishnah gives us some ideas that certain days we add a Haftorah, and also certain days we could add Aliyahs, could make Hosafas. So it's a discussion exactly, it's not so clear when and what, but everyone agrees to is that on Shabbos, one is allowed to have Hosafas. One could add, instead of having 7 people called up, you could have 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. You could have many people called up. Because on Shabbos, since you have the most Aliyahs anyway, 7, so therefore, if it's 8, 9, or 10, it won't make a difference. But according to the Ran, that the amount of people you call up underscores the importance of the day. So therefore, if I have 6 Aliyahs on Yom Kippur, I make it 7, it seems like I'm equating Yom Kippur to Shabbos, or Yontif to Yom Kippur. So our minhag is generally we only make Hosafas on Shabbos, leaving out the issue of Maftir. And even today, the minhag among yeshivas and the minhag hagra is not to make Hosafas even on Shabbos. We'll see why not. If the Mishnah says you can, so what is the Vilna Gaon saying not to? So anyway, the Mishnah says, even though on Shabbos we normally can have a Hosafa, we could make an addition. However, on Shabbos, when we read the portion of the rebuke, the Tochacha, like we'll be reading in Parashas Kisavo, so then the Torah Gemara tells us, Ein mafsikin, we can't interrupt the portion of rebuke. And the question is, why not? What is the reason for Ein mafsikin bekolos, that we can't make an interruption? So the Gemara gives us two reasons. Rav Chiya bar Gamda Amar Rav Asi, Musar Hashem b'ni al timas. The admonishment of Hashem, my son, do not disdain. In other words, basically, when God's giving us rebuke, it's not appropriate to press the pause button. Like in the middle of the listening, okay, God, you know, you'll hear the rest of it later. I have to do something now. When God's talking to you, it's not appropriate to break it up. So therefore, that's why you don't break up the tochacha, because it's inappropriate to interrupt God anytime, but certainly when he's admonishing you. That's one reason in the Gemara. Reish Lakish gives another reason. We do not make a blessing over punishment. In other words, if we were to break stop in the middle of the tochacha, then what would we do? The person would have to make the concluding blessing. And then we call up someone else and they're going to add another bracha in the beginning and a bracha in the end. So even though there's a concept of just like we bless God on the good, we bless him on the bad, that notwithstanding, the Gemara says, Ein omen bracha al prunia. So this is over punishment. We don't want to make a blessing over something which is onesh, which is punishment. So therefore, make a hosafa. So we have this concept similarly in other areas about, not identical, but similar, not to make a bracha over a davara, something which is associated with bad, with evil. So for instance, give you a couple of examples. One is, it's also very inyani diyoma, topical, the mitzvah of tshuva, the mitzvah of returning to God. So according to the Ramban, it's a mitzvah ase min haTorah. It's a positive commandment. So we know that our custom is we make blessings before we do a positive commandment, whether it's biblical, even if it's rabbinical, over near Chanukah candlelight, which is only rabbinical. And we even make blessings over customs, over minhagim. So the question is, why don't we make a bracha on the biblical mitzvah of tshuva? So the many answers maybe we'll save for another time, but the one answer I want to focus on is the same concept, is because why are we doing tshuva? We're not doing tshuva because we did a mitzvah. Well, maybe we are, that we could do the mitzvah even better. But we're doing tshuva is associated with an aveira, which is a sin, a mistake, something we did wrong. And we're doing tshuva, we're repenting, we're returning, we want to take away. Sin causes a block between us and God. So we want to do tshuva to take away the block. So therefore, they point out that since tshuva is, even though tshuva is a great thing, and it's a great mitzvah that God gave us, but since it's associated with a davara, with an aveira, hence no blessing. Like here, we don't want to make a blessing in the middle of the rebuke. We don't want to break it up because we'll have to make a new blessing. Or similar, there's a mitzvah. V'heshiv es ha-gezela. And you return stolen property. There's a mitzvah, if you steal something, there's a mitzvah to return it. Where's the bracha? Why don't we make a bracha on returning stolen property? Because the answer is because it's associated with the sin you made, you stole, so therefore we don't want you to make a bracha, even though what you're doing is a mitzvah. And similarly, as the Rambam's opinion is by shofar, another Rosh Hashanah example, let's say someone steals a shofar. You have a stolen shofar in shul, and the person who's going to blow shofar is going to blow a shofar from a stolen shofar. So can you fulfill your mitzvah with a stolen shofar? Of course, it's not recommended to be using a stolen shofar. That's a given. But is it better not to blow shofar at all? Or should one use the stolen shofar?
Use the stolen shofar if you have no other.
So that's a discussion among the commentators. So the so there's a discussion because there's a principle we know. If you steal a lulav, or if you use a stolen lulav, it's a negative. Better not to do anything, because not only are you violating stealing, gezeila, but you don't get the mitzvah because it's not yours. But however, but the Rambam says by shofar is different. That's a separate shiur. But the Rambam writes that one can fulfill the mitzvah b'di'eved even with the stolen shofar. However, even the Rambam agrees no bracha, because you don't want to make a bracha on something which is associated with an aveira, with something. So therefore, the same concept. We don't want to make a bracha on a davaras. We have a gemara here, ein omen bracha ala prinios. We don't want to break up the portion of rebuke because we're going to add blessings. And we find a similar idea, we said, by returning a stolen object, no bracha, a stolen property, no bracha on tshuva. And even though you could use a stolen shofar, but no blessing. So that's the two opinions in the Gemara. So therefore, what should you do then? So Elohechi Avid, Kishu Matchio, because we don't want to have a bracha on the Tochacha, so what should we do? So Reish Lakish gives us this something very pragmatic. When you begin, you should begin before the portion of rebuke. And Kishu Messiahim, Messiahim Bapasuk Achareim. So they have to basically call up the person for the Aliyah before the portion of rebuke begins, and let him go until afterwards, and therefore you don't have to make a bracha. Because one hand, by breaking up the tochacha, you're definitely adding bracha. We don't want to make any bracha, so we make the bracha, even though the bracha is going on everything, but so to speak, we make the bracha before and the bracha after. And in fact, some have a minute to read the portion of the rebuke very softly. The Chafetz Chaim was very against that practice. So you should be screaming it. This is the part people should be hearing. They're getting their act together. But nevertheless, there's a minute also that since that has the look calling up someone for this aliyah, so usually the minute is the Baal Kore, the one who's reading, who's up there, he does the tochacha because he's already up there. That's just different minhagim. So therefore we have two reasons not to break up the tochacha, either because it's inappropriate to interrupt God when he's giving you a rebuke, and because we don't want to add a blessing to something which involves an onus. So now comes along an Abaye and he qualifies this. We're okay this week according to Abaye. He says, Lo shanu ela bekolo shebetores kohanim. When do we say you can't break up the portion of rebuke? That's when we're reading Parshas Bichukosai, the third book of Moses. We know there are three books of Moses. Five books of Moses. There's Bereshis, Genesis, Shmos, Exodus, Vayikra, Leviticus, Bamidbar, Numbers, and Dvarim, Deuteronomy. So we find the first Tochacha in the third book. That's the book of Torah's Kohanim, the laws of the priest. And we find the second Tochacha this week in the fifth book, in the book of Dvarim. So Rabbi says, it's okay, you could break up the tochacha this week, because we're in Parashas Dvarim, but not the one we read in the third book. So the Gemara says, my taima, Why are we discriminating against the book of Devarim? When we read the Tochacha B'Chukosai, we could be mafsik, we could break it up and call up someone else. But when it comes to Parshas Kisavo, we can't. My time, what's the difference between the rebuke in B'Chukosai, the Tochacha in B'Chukosai, and the Tochacha in Parshas Kisavo? The Gemara answers, Halalu B'Lashin Rabim Amuros, Umosha Ripihagvura Maran. The Halalu B'Lashin Yachid Amuros, Umosha Ripiatzmo Amaran. So, the Gemara tells us something which needs explanation. Let's just tell you what the Gemara says, then we'll have to explain it a little bit more. It says, Moshe, basically, when he was saying over the book of Ayikra, it was completely from HaKadosh Baruch Hu to borrow the expression, Shechina min da'aberes bitok grono shel Moshe. Moshe opened his mouth, and so to speak, the words came out. It was totally him and God one. But in Devarim it says, Moshe mipi atzma. Moshe uttered them on his own. So let's not get the wrong idea. Moshe, even though many biblical critics like to say that the fifth book of Moses was written by someone else, but we say Moses wrote it, and as Tosis points out, B'ruach HaKodesh, he didn't do it on his own. It was just on a lower level of prophecy. In fact, there's a famous Maisa between the Dubno Umagid and the Vilna Gaon. The Dubno Umagid asked the Vilna Gaon, what is the difference between the first four books of Moses and the fifth book? So the Vilna Gaon answered, probably based on this Gemara, that the first four books, it was on the highest level of Nevuah. Moshe mipi hagvura, that he just opened his mouth and the words come out. But the fifth book was Moshe mipi atzmo, so it doesn't mean him on his own. That's apikarsis to say, it's heresy to say Moses wrote the book on his own, but it means it was on a lower level of prophecy. Interesting, we'll go into it maybe more on Shabbos, but Rav Chaim Volozhin, who was the Talmud, was the student of the Vilna Gaon, he said the opposite. He said Sefer Devarim, based on a Ramban, is on a higher level of prophecy than the first four books. And the Rav Soloveitchik had a whole discussion how Sefer Devarim is like the Torah Shebaal Peh of the Torah Shebiksav. It's like the oral law of the, so it was on a Moshe and a Zenith. So that's a separate discussion whether Devarim was on a higher level, lower level, but the way the simple reading of the Gemara, like the Vilna Gaon is saying, that when God is talking directly, so to speak, so ain mafsikin bekolos, so even Abayi agrees. But Devarim, not that it's any less important, but it's not as direct, so therefore Abayi says one could be mafsik. But I think the minhag is today anyway, we're not usually mafsik either in Parshas Kisavo. Is Pinchas raining this week? So you're going to be mafsik in the middle of the Tochacha? Not that he knows of. But that's the minhag, is not to be mafsik anyway in Devarim. But Me'ikar Adin, according to Abayi, the Gemara says there is a difference between the book of Devarim and the book of Torah's Kohanim. So that's why we have two reasons. The Mishnah says, Ein mafsikin b'kolos, why not? Either because it's inappropriate to put God on the pause button while he's talking to you, or like Rish Lakish said, if we're mafsik, we'll have to add a new bracha, and therefore we don't want to add a bracha on a davara, on a prunia. So that's why there's no bracha on tshuva, there's no bracha on a stolen shofar, there's no bracha on hashavas gezela, because we don't make a bracha on something which is associated with a avera, a davara, prunias. However, one can ask the following question. This is a new practice. The old practice was that only one person made a blessing, the Kohen. When he got called up for the first Aliyah, he made the blessing. And then the last person, whoever got Shvi, whoever got called up at the end, he made the bracha achrona. He made the last bracha. There's only one bracha on Kriyas HaTorah. Later on, the minhag changed that we add a new bracha every person who gets. That's a later institution. So what is Reish Lakish talking about? Before the takana, what do you mean? It used to be, even when you called up people, you didn't make a new bracha. So what do you mean, Ein Mevarchin Al Prunias? There was no bracha. Only the person in the beginning made a bracha. Only person at the end made a bracha. So that makes sense according to the way we have it today. But back in the day where they didn't have it, so what's Reish Lakish talking about? So some point out it wasn't so simple. That wasn't such a clear-cut rule. That some say, I think the Taz writes with the Ritva, that was only normally if you were in shul at the time and you heard the bracha, you had in mind to be yotze. But let's say a person walked in after and he got revi. So some say, no, he had to make his own bracha. It's only if you were in shul at the time, it wasn't carved in gold. That's what some want to claim. And others say, no, it is carved in gold. You only make one bracha, so therefore what is it? So that's what we'll explain right now. The end of the Gemara says, Rav Shimon ben Elazar Omer, Ezra tiken lahem liYisrael, Ezra instituted for the Jewish people, sheyukorin kola shebetores kohanim kodem atzeres, you should read the portion of rebuke, bechukosai, before Shavuos, uvisha Mishneh Torah and the Book of Devarim, kisavo kodem Rosh Hashanah. My time of what do we want to get the portion of rebuke in? So the Gemara says, kadesh tichle Hashana v'chulu said, we want to get rid of the curses and let's begin with the blessings. Let's get the curses over with and start the year fresh. So Bishlom Hashemah Mishneh Torah, I understand now, Rosh Hashanah is coming up, it's a new year. Kadesh Tichle Shana, we get the curses over with. Elo Shabbataris Kohanim, Otu Atzeres Rosh Hashanah. Since when did Shavuos become the new year? That we're worried that we want to get the curses over with before Shavuos. The Gemara says, in, yes. Shavuos, we have four new years, and Shavuos is a new year. Atzeres Nami Rosh Hashanah Ditznan, Uvi Atzeres Alperes Ha'ilan. That it is Judgment Day about the previous year's curses. You know, it's we're judged concerning the fruit of the tree. So either way, but the point being is, Ezra made it instituted. So let me ask you something. What do you mean Ezra instituted? That's the way it comes out. I don't need Ezra. Kisavo comes out that way. Kisavo comes out before Rosh Hashanah. Of course, Ezra instituted Kriyas HaTorah also, but what I mean to get at is, we didn't always, our custom today is, see, two things changed. Number one is, we had one person making a bracha and that's it. One bracha in the beginning, one at the end. But also, we had a three-year cycle in Eretz Yisrael. They used to finish the Torah once every 3 years, not every year. So we finish every year, so it works out, Kisavo comes out at the appropriate time. But let's say when it was a three-year cycle, it didn't work out. So that's what we're talking about. So therefore, it was a special Takanas Ezra. Even if we weren't reading Parshas Kisavo before Rosh Hashanah, if we went with the cycle where we didn't even, Kisavo's not coming up, there's a separate obligation to read the Tochacha before Rosh Hashanah. And that's what Reish Lakish is saying. Even before our institution of reading Kisavo, we read in Parsha every week. We finish a Parsha every week and we read Kisavo. there's a separate institution, even if we weren't, that we should have to take out the book of Devarim and read from the Tochacha. That's a separate, since it's a separate obligation, that had its own bracha as well. So therefore, even according to Reish Lakish, who says the reason is we don't want to add brachas on the prunios, but even during that day, before we have our institution today, nevertheless, they point out that there's still an issue. There's still an issue with the bracha. So that's why. So that's the special takana of Ezra, and that's why today, even though the Mishnah says that on Shabbos is no problem of having hosafis, nevertheless, the minhag in yeshivas following the minhag hagra is not to have hosafis, not to have additions, because they say today it's different. Today we're adding brachas. It was no big deal at the time of the Mishnah. You could call up 20 people, you're only making one bracha. But today, that each person making a bracha, not that there's a problem with it, but the Vilna Gaon, I guess, felt it's better not to make hosafis today, not to make additions today, when we have each person is going to make his own bracha. So, to summarize, we spoke about the Mishnah said, Ein mafsikin, we don't break up the tochacha, either because it's inappropriate, or both, it is inappropriate. And also, we don't want to add a bracha. If we break it up, we're going to add a new blessing. And we don't add a blessing on something which is associated with the sin. Tshuva, we don't make a bracha on. Returning stolen object, using a stolen shofar, etc. And that's why, that's why we start the tochacha before, we start our aliyah before the tochacha, and afterwards we shouldn't have a bracha directly on the tochacha. Abayi says that only applies to the book of Vayikra, Bechukosai, but not to the book of Devarim, because since Devarim is on a low level of prophecy, so it's okay to break it up. Alaminik is not to break it up anyway. And then we pointed out that, and that's the difference, that Ezra instituted to read the Tochacha regardless, and therefore even in the time, today we're reading Kisavu anyway, even in the time when there wasn't, when we didn't finish the Torah all the time, nevertheless, we went ahead and we read Takanas Ezra, and therefore even it was Man HaMishnah, when they didn't have a bracha, anytime you read the Tocha, you would add a new bracha. And I'll throw out a question for you, we'll discuss on Shabbos. There's another difference between the Tochacha, between Parshas Kisavo and Parshas Bechukosai. The Parshas Bechukosai ends with hope, with the Nechama, comfort. It says, and don't worry, the Eskor as Avos, I remember our Avos. So it's a terrible Tochacha, but at least it ends with Nechama. It ends with hope. However, Parshas Kisavo ends abruptly. And you know what? You're going to be sold. You'll be taken down to Egypt, sold as slaves. No one's going to want you. The very ends abruptly without any hope. The question is, what is the difference? Why does Parshas Bechukosai end with hope, with a nechama, but Parshas Kisavo ends abruptly?